चैप्टर वन वेरिएशंस इन साइकोलॉजिकल एट्रीब्यूट्स इंट्रोडक्शन इफ़ यू ऑब्जर्व योर फ्रेंड्स क्लासमेट्स और रिलेटिव्स यू विल फाइंड हाउ दे डिफर फ्रॉम ईच अदर इन द मैनर दे परसीव लर्न एंड थिंक एज ऑल्सो इन द परफॉर्मेंस ऑफ वेरियस टास्क सच इंडिविजुअल डिफरेंसेज कैन बी नोटिस्ड इन एवरी वॉक ऑफ लाइफ द पीपल डिफर फ्रॉम वन अनदर इज ऑब्वियस In class 11th, you have learned about psychological principles that are applied to understand human behavior. We also need to know how people differ, what brings about these differences, and how such differences can be assessed. You will recall how one of the main concerns of modern psychology has been the study of individual differences from time of Galton. This chapter will introduce you to some of the fundamentals of individual differences. One of the most popular psychological attributes which has been of interest to psychologists is intelligence. People differ from each other in their ability to understand complex ideas, adapt to environment, learn from experience, engage in various forms of reasoning, and to overcome obstacles. In this chapter, you will study the nature of intelligence, changing definitions of intelligence, cultural differences in intelligence, range, and variations in the intellectual competencies of people and the nature of special abilities or aptitudes. Individual differences in human functioning. Individual variations are common within and across all species. Variations add color and beauty to nature. For a moment, think of a world around you where each and every object is of the same color, say red or blue or green. How would the world appear to you? Certainly not a beautiful one. Would you prefer to live in such a world? In all likelihood, your answer will be no. Like objects, people too possess different combination of traits. Variability is a fact of nature, and individuals are no exception to this. They vary in terms of physical characteristics, such as height, weight, strength, hair, color, and so on. They also vary along psychological dimensions. They may be intelligent or dull, dominant or submissive, creative or not so creative, outgoing or withdrawn. The list of variations can be endless. Different traits can exist in varying degrees in an individual. In this sense, each one of is unique, as she or he exemplifies a typical combination of various traits. The question which you may like to pose is how and why people differ. Thus, in fact, the subject matter of the study of individual differences. For psychologists, individual differences refer to distinctiveness and variations among people's characteristics and behavior patterns. While many psychologists believe that our behaviors are influenced by our personal traits, some others hold the view that our behaviors are influenced more by situational factors. This latter view is known as situationism, which states that situations and circumstances in which one is placed influence one's behavior. A person who is generally aggressive may behave in a submissive manner in the presence of her or his top boss. Sometimes the situational influences are so powerful that individuals with differing personality traits respond to them in almost the same ways. A situationist perspective views human behavior as resulting from interaction of external and internal factors. Assessment of psychological attributes. Psychological attributes are involved in very simple phenomena like the time taken to react to stimulus, that is reaction time, and also in highly global concepts like happiness. It is difficult to count and specify the number of psychological attributes that can be assessed. Assessment is the first step in understanding a psychological attribute. Assessment refers to the measurement of psychological attributes of individuals and their evaluation. Often using multiple methods in terms of certain standards of comparison. Any attribute will be said to exist in a person only if it can be measured by using scientific procedures. For example, when we say Harish is dominant, we are referring to the degree of dominance in Harish. This statement is based on our own assessment of dominance in him. Our assessment may be informal or formal. Formal assessment is objective, standardized, and organized. On the other hand, informal assessment varies from case to case and from assessor to another, and therefore is open to subjective interpretations. Psychologists are trained in making formal assessment of psychological attributes. Once assessment is done, we can use this information to predict how Harish will probably behave in future. We may predict that Harish, if given a chance to lead a team, will most likely be an authoritarian team leader, or if we predicted the consequence is not what we want, we may want to intervene to effect a change in Harish's behavior. The attribute chosen for assessment depends on our purpose. In order to help a weak student perform well in her examination, we may assess her or his intellectual strengths and weaknesses. If a person fails to adjust with member of her or his family and neighborhood, we may consider assessing her personality characteristics. For a poorly motivated person, we may assess her or his interest and preferences. Psychological assessment uses systematic testing procedures to evaluate abilities, behaviors, and personal qualities of individuals. Some domains of psychological attributes. Psychological attributes are not linear or unidimensional. They are complex and expressed in terms of dimensions. A line is a mere aggregate of many points. A point occupies no space. But think of a box. It occupies space. It can be described only in terms of its three dimensions, that is length, width, and height. Similar is the case with psychological attributes. They are usually multidimensional. If you want to have a complete assessment of a person, you'll need to assess how she or he functions in various domains or areas such as cognitive, emotional, social, etc. We'll discuss in this chapter some of important attributes that are interest to psychologists. These attributes are categorized on the basis of varieties of tests used in psychological literature. Intelligence is the global capacity to understand the world, think rationally, and use available resources effectively when faced with challenges. Intelligence tests provide a global measure of a person's general cognitive competence, including the ability to profit from schooling. Generally, students having low intelligence are not likely to do well in school-related exams, but their success in life is not associated with intelligence test scores. Aptitude refers to an individual's underlying potential for acquiring skills. Aptitude tests are used to predict what an individual will be able to do if given proper environment and training. A person with high mechanical aptitude can profit from appropriate training and can do well as an engineer. Similarly, a person having high language aptitude can be trained to be a good writer. Interest is an individual's preference for engaging in one or more specific activities related to others. Assessment of interest of students may help to decide what subject or courses they can pursue comfortably and with pleasure. Knowledge of interest help us in making choices that promote life satisfaction and promotion performance on jobs. Personality refers to relatively enduring characteristics of a person that make her or him distinct from others. Personality tests try to assess an individual's unique characteristics, whether one is dominant or submissive, outgoing or withdrawn, moody or emotionally stable, etc. Personality assessment helps us to explain an individual's behavior and predict how he/she will behave in future. Values are enduring beliefs about an ideal mode of behavior. A person having a value set, a standard for guiding his or her actions, and also for judging others. In value assessment, we try to determine the dominant values of a person, example, political, religious, social, or economic. Assessment methods. Several methods are used for psychological assessment. We have learned about some of these methods in class 11th. Let us recall their key features. Psychological test is an objective and standardized measure of an individual's mental and/or behavior characteristics. Objective tests have been developed to measure all the dimensions of psychological attributes described above. These tests are widely used for the purpose of clinical diagnosis, guidance, personal selection, placement, and training. Besides objective tests, psychologists have also developed certain projective tests, especially for the assessment of personality. You will learn about them in Chapter 2. Interview involves seeking information from a person on a one-to-one basis. You may see it being used when a counselor interacts with a client. A salesperson makes a door-to-door survey regarding the usefulness of a particular product. An employer selects employees for his or her organization. Or a journalist interviews important people on issues of national and international importance. Case study is an in-depth study of the individual in terms of her or his psychological attributes, psychological history in the context of her or his psychosocial and physical environment. Case studies are widely used for clinical psychologists. Case analysis of the lives of great people can also be highly illuminating for those willing to learn from their experiences. Case studies are based on data generated by different methods, example interview, observation, questionnaire, archaeological test, etc. Observation involves employing systematic, organized and objective procedures to record behavioral phenomena occurring naturally in real time. Certain phenomena such as mother-child interactions can be easily studied through observation. The major problems with observational methods are that the observer has little control over the situation and the reports may suffer from subjective interpretation of the observer. Theory of Multiple Intelligences. Howard Gardner proposed the theory of multiple intelligences. According to him, intelligence is not a single entity, rather distinct types of intelligence exist. Each of these intelligences are independent of each other. This means that if a person exhibits one type of intelligence, it does not necessarily indicate being high or low on other types of intelligences. Gardner also put forth that different types of intelligences interact and work together to find a solution to a problem. Gardner studied extremely talented persons who had shown exceptional abilities in their respective areas and described 8 types of intelligence. These are as follows. Linguistic. It is the capacity of use of language fluently and flexibly to express one's thinking and understand others. Persons high on this intelligence are word smart. That is, they are sensitive to different shades of word meanings, are articulate, and can create linguistic images in their mind. Poets and writers are very strong in this component of intelligence. Logical or mathematical. Persons high on this type of intelligence can think logically and critically. They engage in abstract reasoning and can manipulate symbols to solve mathematical problems. Scientists and Nobel Prize winners are likely to be strong in this component. Spatial. It refers to the abilities involved in forming, using, and transforming mental images. The person high on this intelligence can easily represent the spatial world in the mind. Pilots, sailors, sculptors, painters, architects, interior decorators, and surgeons are likely to have highly developed spatial intelligence. Musical. It is capacity to produce, create, and manipulate musical patterns. Persons high on this intelligence are very sensitive to sounds and vibrations and creating new patterns of sounds. Bodily. Kinesthetic. This consists of the use of the whole body or portions of it for display or construction of products and problem solving. Athletes, dancers, actors, sportspersons, gymnasts, and surgeons are likely to have such kind of intelligence. Interpersonal. This is the skill of understanding the motives, feelings, and behaviors of other people so as to bond in a comfortable relationship with others. Psychologists, counselors, politicians, social workers, and religious leaders are likely to possess high interpersonal intelligence. Intrapersonal. This refers to the knowledge of one's internal strength and limitation and using the knowledge to effectively relate to others. Persons high on the ability to have finer sensibilities regarding their identity, human existence, and meaning of life. Philosophers and spiritual leaders present examples of this type of intelligence. Naturalistic. This involves complete awareness of relationship with the natural world. It is useful in recognizing the beauty of different species of flora and fauna and making subtle discriminations in the natural world. Hunters, farmers, tourists, botanists, zoologists, and bird watchers possess more of naturalistic intelligence. Triarchic theory of intelligence. Robert Sternberg proposed the TARC theory of intelligence. Solomon views intelligence as the ability to adapt, to shape, and select environment to accomplish one's good and those of one's society and culture. According to this theory, there are three basic types of intelligence: componential, experiential, and contextual. The elements of TARC theory of intelligence are shown. Componential intelligence or analytical intelligence is the analysis of information to solve problems. Persons high on the ability to think analytically and critically and succeed in schools. This intelligence has three components, each serving a different function. First is the knowledge acquisition component, which is responsible for learning and acquisition of the ways of doing things. The second is meta or a high order component, which involves planning concerning what to do and how to do. Third is the performance component, which involves actually doing things. Experiential intelligence or creative intelligence is involved in using past problem experiences creatively to find novel problems. It is reflected in creative performance. Purposes high on this aspect integrate different experiences in an original way to make new discoveries and inventions. They quickly find out which information is crucial in a given situation. Contextual intelligence or practical intelligence involves the ability to deal with environmental demands encountered on a daily basis. It may be called street smartness or business sense. Persons high on this aspect easily adapt to their present environment or select a more favorable environment than the existing one, or modify the environment to fit their needs. Therefore, they turn out to be successful in life. Sternberg's triarchic theory of intelligence represents information processing approach to understand intelligence, planning, attention arousal, and simultaneous successive past model of intelligence. This self-report is a method in which a person provides factual information about herself, himself, and her opinions, beliefs that she holds or he holds. Such information may be obtained by using an interview schedule or a questionnaire, a psychological test, or a personal diary. Intelligence. Intelligence is a key construct employed to know how individuals differ from one another. It also provides an understanding of how people adapt their behavior according to the environment they live in. In this section, you will read about intelligence in its various forms. Psychological notion of intelligence is quite different from the commonsensical notion of intelligence. If you watch an intelligent person, you are likely to see her or him attributes like mental alertness, ready wit, quickness in learning, and ability to understand relationships. The Oxford Dictionary explains intelligence as the power of perceiving, learning, understanding, and knowing. Early intelligence theorists also used these attributes in defining intelligence. Alfred Binet was one of the first psychologists who worked on intelligence. He defined intelligence as the ability to judge well, understand well, and reason well. Whistler, whose intelligence tests are most widely used, understood intelligence in terms of functionality, its value for adaptation for environment. He defined it as the global and aggregate capacity of an individual to think rationally, act purposefully, and to deal effectively with his or her environment. Other psychologists, such as Gardner and Sternberg, have suggested that an intelligent individual not only adapts to the environment, but also actively modifies or shapes it. You will be able to understand the concept of intelligence and how it is evolved when we discuss some important theories of intelligence. Theories of intelligence. Psychologists have proposed several theories of intelligence. Theories can be broadly classified as either representing a psychometric structural approach or an information processing approach. The psychometric approach considers intelligence as an aggregate of abilities. It expresses the individual's performance in terms of a single index of cognitive abilities. On the other hand, the information processing approach describes the process people use in intellectual reasoning and problem solving. The major focus on this approach is on how an intelligent person acts. rather than focusing on structure of intelligence or its underlying dimensions, information processing approaches emphasize studying cognitive functions underlying intelligent behavior. We'll discuss some representative theories of these approaches. We mentioned above that Albert Binet was the first psychologist who tried to formalize the concept of intelligence in terms of mental operations. Prior to him, we find the notion of intelligence described in general ways in various philosophical treatises available in different cultural traditions. Binet's theory of intelligence was rather simple, as it arose from his interest in differentiating more intelligent from less intelligent individuals. He therefore conceptualized intelligence as consisting of one similar set of abilities which can be used for solving any or every problem in an individual's environment. His theory of intelligence is called uni or one factor theory of intelligence. This theory came to be disputed when psychologists started analyzing data of individuals, which was collected using Binet's data. In 1927, Charles Fuhrman proposed a two-factor theory of intelligence, employing a statistical method called factor analysis. He showed that intelligence consisted of general factor and some specific factors. The G factor includes mental operations, which are primary and common to all performances. In addition to the G factor, he said that there are also many specific abilities. These are contained in what he called the S factor. So excellent singers, architects, scientists, and athletes may be on high G factor, but in addition to this, there are specific abilities to which allow them to excel in their respective domains. Spearman's theory was followed by Louis Thurston's theory. He proposed the theory of primary mental abilities. It states that intelligence consists of even primary abilities, each of which is relatively independent of others. These primary abilities are verbal comprehension, numerical abilities, spatial relations, perceptual speed, word fluency, memory, and inductive reasoning deriving general rules from presented facts. Arthur Jensen proposed a hierarchical model of intelligence consisting of abilities operating at two levels, level 1 and level 2. Level 1 is associative learning, in which output is more or less similar to the input. Level 2, called cognitive competence, involves higher order skills as they transform the inputs to produce an effective output. J.P. Guilford proposed the structure of intellect model, which classifies the intellectual traits among three dimensions: operations, contents, and products. Operations are what the respondent does. These include cognition, memory, recording, memory retention, divergent production, convergent production, and evaluation. Content refers to the nature of materials or information on which intellectual operations are performed. These include visual, auditory, symbolic, semantic, and behavioral. Products refer to the form in which information is processed by the respondent. Products are classified into units, classes, relations, systems, transformations, and implications. Since the classification includes 6 into 5 into 6 categories, therefore the model has 180 cells. Each cell is expected to have at least one factor or ability. Some cells may have more than one factor. Each factor is described in terms of all three dimensions. The above mentioned theory is a representation of psychometric approach to understand intelligent behavior. This model has been developed by J.P. Das, Jack Naglieri, and Kirby. According to this model, intellectual activities involves the interdependent functioning of three neurological systems called the functional units of brain. These units are responsible for arousal, attention, coding or processing, and planning respectively. Arousal/attention. State of arousal is basic to any behavior, as it helps us to attending to stimuli. Arousal and attention enable a person to process information. An optimal level of arousal focuses on our attention to the relevant aspects of the problem. Too much or too little arousal would interfere with attention. For instance, when you are told by a teacher about a test he or she plans to hold, it will arouse you to attend to the specific chapters. Arousal forces you to focus your attention on reading, learning, and revising the contents of the chapters. Simultaneous and successive processing. You can integrate the information into your knowledge system either simultaneously or successively. Simultaneous processing takes place when you perceive the relation among various concepts and integrate them into a meaningful pattern for comprehension. For example, in Riemann's progressive matrix test, a design is presented from which a part has been removed. You are required to choose one of the six options which best completes the design. Simultaneously processing helps you in grasping the meaning and relationship between the given abstract figures. Successive processing takes place when you remember all the information serially so that the recall of one leads to the recall of another. Learning of digits, alphabets, multiplication tables, etc. are examples of successive processing. Planning. This is an essential feature of intelligence. After the information is attended to and processed, planning is activated. It allows us to think of the possible course of action, implement them and reach a target, and evaluate their effectiveness. If a plan does not work, it is modified to suit the requirements of the task or situation. For example, to take the test schedule by a teacher, you would have to set goals, plan a time schedule of study, get clarification in case of problems, and if you are not able to tackle the chapters assigned for the test, you have to think of other ways to meet your goals. These past processes operate on a knowledge base developed either formally or informally from the environment. These processes are interactive and dynamic in nature, yet each has its own distinctive function. Das and Naglieri have also developed a battery of tests known as cognitive assessment system. It consists of verbal as well as non-verbal tasks that measure basic cognitive functions presumed to be independent of the schooling. The battery of tests is meant for individuals between 5 and 18 years of age. The results of assessment can be used to remedy cognitive deficits of children with learning models. This model represents the information processing approach to intelligence. Individual differences in intelligence. Why are some people more intelligent than others? Is it due to their heredity or is it due to their influence of environmental factors? You have already read about the influence of these factors in the development of individual in class 11th. Intelligence, interplay of nature and nurture. The evidence for hereditary influences on intelligence comes mainly from studies on twins and adopted children. The intelligence of identical twins reared together correlate almost 0.90. Twins separated early in childhood also show considerable similarity in their intellectual personality and behavioral characteristics. The intelligence of identical twins reared in different environments correlate 0.72. Those of fraternal twins reared together correlate almost 0.60, and those of brothers and sisters reared together correlate about 0.50, while siblings reared apart correlate about 0.25. Another line of evidence comes from the studies of adopted children, which show that children's intelligence is more similar to their biological rather than adoptive parents. With respect to role of environment, studies have reported that as children grow in age, their intelligence level tends to move closer to that of their adoptive parents. Children from disadvantaged homes adopted into families with higher socioeconomic status exhibit a large increase in their intelligence scores. There is evidence that environmental deprivation lowers intelligence, while rich nutrition, good family background, and quality schooling increase intelligence. There is a general consensus among the psychologists that intelligence is a product of complex interaction of heredity and environment. Heredity can be best viewed as something that sets a range within which an individual's development is actually shaped by support and opportunities of the environment. Assessment of intelligence. In 1905, Alfred Binet and Theodore Simon made the first successful attempt to formally measure intelligence in 1908 when the scale was revised. They gave the concept of mental age, which is a measure of personal intellectual development relative to people of her or his age group. A mental age of 5 means a child performance on an intelligence test equal the average performance level of a group 5 years old. Chronological age is the biological age from birth. A birth child MA is more than his or her CA. For adult child, MA is below the CA. Retardation was defined by Binet and Simon as being mental age between years below the chronological age.
In 1912, William Stone, a German psychologist, devised the concept of intelligent quotient. IQ refers to mental age divided by chronological age and multiplied by 100. The number 100 is used as a multiplier to avoid decimal point. When MA equals the CA, it equals 100. If MA is more than CA, IQ is more than 100. IQ becomes less than 100 when MA is less than the CA. For example, a 10-year-old with mental age of 12 would have an IQ of 120, whereas the same child with an MA of 7 would have an IQ of 70. The average IQ in the population is 100, irrespective of age. IQ scores are distributed in the population in such a way that the scores of most people tend to fall in the middle range of the distribution. Only a few people have either very high or very low scores. The frequency distribution of IQ scores tends to approximate a bell-shaped curve called a normal curve. The type of distribution is symmetrical around the central value called the mean. The distribution of IQ scores in the form of a normal distribution is shown. The mean IQ score in a population is 100. People with IQ scores in the range of 90 to 110 have normal intelligence. Those with IQ 70 below suspected to have mental retardation, while retardation persons IQ above 130 are considered to have exceptional talents. The IQ score of a person can be interpreted by referring to table. All persons do not have the same intellectual capacity. Some are exceptionally bright and some are below average. One practical use of intelligence test is to identify persons at the extremes of the intellectual functioning. If you refer to table, you will notice that about 2% of the population have above IQ 130 and a similar percentage have IQ below 70. The persons in the first group are called intellectually gifted. Those in the second group are termed as mentally challenged or mentally retarded. These two groups deviate considerably from the normal population in respect of their cognitive, emotional and motivational characteristics. Variations of intelligence. Intellectual deficiency, on one hand, are the gifted creative persons we discussed briefly earlier. On the other hand, there are children who face enormous difficulty in learning even very simple skills. Those children who show intellectual deficiency are termed as mentally challenged or mentally retarded. As a group, there is wide variation among the mentally deficient or retarded. The American Association of Mental Deficiency views mental retardation as significantly sub-average general intellectual functioning existing concurrently with deficits in adaptive behavior and manifested during the developmental period. This definition points to three basic features. First, in order to be judged as mentally retarded, a person must show significantly sub-average intellectual functioning. Persons having IQs below 70 are judged to have sub-average intelligence. The second relates to deficits in adaptive behavior. Adaptive behavior refers to a person's capacity to be independent and deal effectively with one's environment. The third feature is that the deficits must be observed during the developmental period, that is between 0 and 18 years of age. Individuals who are categorized as having mental retardation show significant variation in their abilities, ranging from those who can be taught to work and function with special attention to those who cannot be trained and require institutional care throughout their lives. You have learned that mean IQ score is the population is 100. These figures are used to understand the categories of mentally retarded. The different types of retardation are mild retardation, moderate retardation, severe retardation, and profound retardation. Although the development of people with mild retardation is typically slower than that their peers, they can function quite independently, hold jobs and families. As the level of retardation increases, the difficulties are strongly marked. People with moderate retardation lag behind their peers in language and motor skills. They can be trained in self-care skills and simple and social communication skills. They need to have moderate degree of supervision in everyday tasks. Individuals with profound and severe retardation are incapable of managing life and need constant care for their entire lives. We will read about more of these characteristics in Chapter 4, Intellectual Giftedness. intellectually gifted individuals show higher performance because of their outstanding potentialities. The study of gifted individuals in 1925, when Louis Terman followed the lives of 1500 children with IQs of 130 and about to examine how intelligence was related to occupational success and life adjustment. Although the terms talent and giftedness are often interchangeably used, they mean different things. Giftedness is exceptional general ability shown in superior performance in a wide range of variety of areas. Talent is a narrower term and refers to remarkable ability in a specific field. The highly talented sometimes are called prodigies. It has been suggested by psychologists that giftedness from the teacher's point of view depends on a combination of high ability, high creativity, and high commitment. Gifted children show early signs of intellectual superiority even during infancy and early childhood. They show large attention span, good recognition memory, preference for novelty, sensitivity to environmental changes, and early appearance of language skills. To adequate giftedness with brilliant academic performance is not correct. It leads to show superior psychomotor ability are also gifted. Each gifted student possesses different strengths, personalities, and characteristics. Some important characteristics are advanced logical thinking, questioning and problem-solving behavior, high-speed processing information, superior generalization and discrimination ability, advanced level of original and creative thinking, high level of intrinsic motivation and self-esteem, independent and non-conformist thinking, preference for solitary academic activities for long periods. Performance on intelligence test is not only the measure for identifying the gifted. Many other information sources such as teachers' judgment, school achievement record, parents' interviews, peer and self-rating can be used in combination with intellectual assessment. To reach their full potential, gifted children require special attention and different educational programs beyond those provided to normal children in regular classrooms. These may include life enrichment programs that can sharpen children's skills in productive thinking, planning, decision making, and communication. Types of intelligence tests. Intelligence tests are of several types. On the basis of their administration procedure, they can be categorized as individual or group test. They can also be classified as either verbal or performance test on the basis of nature of items used. Depending upon extent to which an intelligence test favors one culture over another, it can be judged either as culture fair or culture biased. You can choose a test depending on the purpose for your use. Individual or group test. An individual intelligence test is one which can be administered to one person at a time. A group intelligence test can be administered to several persons simultaneously. Individual tests require the test administrator to establish a rapport with the subject and be sensitive to her or his feelings, moods, and expressions during the testing session. Group tests, however, do not allow an opportunity to be familiar with the subject's feelings. individual tests allow people to answer orally or in a written form or manipulate objects as per testers' instructions. Groups test generally seek written answers, usually in a multiple choice format. Verbal, non-verbal, or performance test. An intelligence test may be fully verbal, fully non-verbal, or fully performance-based, or it may consist of a mixture of items from each category. Verbal test requires subjects to give verbal responses, either orally or in a written form. Therefore, verbal tests can be administered only to literate people. The non-verbal test use pictures or illustrations as test items. Raven's progressive matrices test is an example of a non-verbal test. In this test, the subject examines an incomplete pattern. Choose a figure from an interlatives that will complete the pattern. Specimen is given. Performance tests require subjects to manipulate objects and other materials to perform a task. Written language is not necessary for answering the items. For example, SCO's block design test contains a number of wooden blocks. The subject is asked to arrange the blocks within a time period to produce a given design. A major disadvantage of performance tests is that they can be easily administered to persons from different cultures, culture fair or culture biased tests. Intelligence tests can be culture fair or culture biased. Many intelligence tests show a bias to the culture in which they are developed. Tests developed in America and Europe represent urban and middle class structure ethos. Hence, educated middle class white subjects generally perform well on those tests. The items do not respect the cultural perspective of Asia and Africa. The norms of these tests are also drawn from Western cultural groups. You may be already familiar with the concept of norms discussed in class 11th. It is nearly impossible to design a test that can be applied equally meaningfully to all cultures. Psychologists have tried to culturally appropriate, that is, one that does not discriminate against individuals belonging to different cultures. In such tests, items are constructed in a manner that they assess experiences common to all cultures or have questions in which language usage is not required. Nonverbal and performance tests help reduce the cultural bias usually associated with the verbal test. Nonverbal and performance tests help reduce the cultural bias usually associated with verbal test. Intelligence testing in India. S.M. Mohsin made a pioneering attempt in constructing an intelligence test in Hindi in 1930s. Rice attempted to standardize Venus test in Urdu and Punjabi. At about the same time, Mahal Lenobis attempted to standardize Venus test in Bengali. Attempts were developed, also made by Indian researchers to develop Indian norms for some Western tests, including RPMWAIS, Alexander's pass along, cube construction, and coarse block design. Long and Mehta prepared a book of mental measurement handbook listing out 103 tests of intelligence in India that were available in various languages. Since then, a number of tests have been either developed or adapted from Western cultures. The National Library of Educational and Psychological Test at the National Council of Educational Research and Training has documented Indian test. Critical reviews of Indian tests are published in the form of handbooks. NLEPT has brought out the handbooks in the area of intelligence, aptitude, personality, attitudes and interest. Table lists some tests developed in India. Among these, Bhatia's battery of performance tests is quite popular. Culture and intelligence. A major characteristic of intelligence is that it helps individuals to adapt to their environment.
The cultural environment provides a context for intelligence to develop. Yotsky, a Russian psychologist, has argued that the culture provides a social context in which people live, grow, and understand the world around them. For example, in less technologically developed societies, social and emotional skills in relating to people are valued, while in the technologically advanced societies, personal achievement founded on abilities of reasoning and judgment is considered to represent intelligence. For a previous reading, you know that culture is a collective system of custom beliefs, attitudes, and achievement in art and literature. A person's intelligence is likely to be tuned by these cultural parameters. Many theorists have regarded intelligence as attributes specific to the person, without regard to their cultural background. The unique features of culture now find some representation in theories of intelligence. Sternberg's notion of contextual or practical intelligence implies that intelligence is a product of culture. Yotsky also believed that cultures, like individuals, have a life of their own. They grow and change, and in the process specify what will be the end product of successful intellectual development. According to him, while elementary mental functions are universal, the manner in which higher mental functions, such as problem solving and thinking, operate are largely cultural produced. Technologically advanced societies adopt child-rearing practices that foster skills of generalization and abstraction, speed, minimal moves, and mental manipulation among children. These societies promote a type of behavior which can be called technological intelligence. In these societies, persons are well versed in skills of attention, observation analysis, performance, speed, and achievement orientation. Intelligence tests developed in Western cultures look precisely for these skills in an individual. Technological intelligence is not so valued in many Asian and African societies. The qualities and skills regarded as intelligent actions in non-Western cultures are sharply different. Though the boundaries are gradually vanishing under the influence of Western cultures, in addition to cognitive competence that is very specific to the individual, the non-Western cultures looks for skills to relate to others in the society. Some non-Western societies value self-reflection and collective orientation as opposed to personal achievement and individualistic orientation. Intelligence in the Indian tradition. Contrary to the technical intelligence, intelligence in Indian tradition can be termed as integral intelligence, which gives emphasis on connectivity with the social and world environment. Indian thinkers view intelligence from a holistic perspective where equal attention is paid to cognitive and non-cognitive processes as well as their integration. The Sanskrit word buddhi, which is more often used to represent intelligence, is far more pervasive in scope than the Western concept of intelligence. Buddhi, according to J.P. Das, includes such skills as mental effort, determined actions, feelings, and opinions, along with cognitive competence such as knowledge, discrimination, and other understanding. Among other things, buddhi is the knowledge of oneself based on conscience, will, and desire. Thus, the notion of buddhi has affective and motivational components, besides a strong cognitive component. Unlike the Western views, it primarily focuses on cognitive parameters. The following competencies are identified as facets of intelligence in the Indian tradition: cognitive capacity, social competence, emotional competence, entrepreneurial competence, emotional intelligence. The notion of
Emotional intelligence broadens the concept of intelligence beyond the intellectual sphere or domain and considers that intelligence includes emotion. You may note that it builds on the concept of intelligence in the Indian tradition. Emotional intelligence is a set of skills that underlie accurate appraisal, expression, and regulation of emotions. It is the feeling side of intelligence. A good IQ and scholastic record is not enough to be successful in life. You may find many people who are academically talented but are unsuccessful in their own life. They experience problems in family, workplace, and interpersonal relationships. What do they lack? Some psychologists believe that the source of their difficulty may be a lack of emotional intelligence. This concept was first introduced by Selloway and Mayer, who considered emotional intelligence as the ability of motor one's own and others' emotions to discriminate among them and to use information to guide one's thinking and actions. Emotional quotient is used to express emotional intelligence in the same way as IQ is used to express intelligence. In simple terms, emotional intelligence refers to the ability to process emotional information accurately and efficiently. To know the characteristics of persons who are high emotional intelligence, read box 1.2. Emotional intelligence is receiving increasing attention of educators for dealing with students who are affected by stresses and challenges of the outside world. Programs aimed at improving students' emotional intelligence have beneficial effects on their academic achievement. They increase cooperative behavior and reduce their antisocial activities. These programs are very useful in preparing students to face challenges of life outside the classroom. Special abilities, aptitude, nature, and measurement. By now you have learned about intelligence. You may recall that intelligence test assess a general mental ability. Aptitude refers to special abilities in a particular field of activity. It is a combination of characteristics that indicates an individual's capacity to acquire some specific knowledge or skill after training. We assess aptitude with the help of selected tests. The knowledge of aptitude can help us to predict an individual's future performance. While assessing intelligence, psychologists often found that people with similar intelligence differed widely in acquiring certain knowledge or skills.
You may observe in your class that there are certain areas in which some intelligent students do not do well. When you have a problem in mathematics, you may turn to Aman for help. With similar difficulties in literature, you may consult Avinash. You may request Shabnam to sing for an algebra function and may turn to John when facing a problem with your bike. These specific skills and abilities are called aptitudes. With proper training, and these abilities can be considerably enhanced. In order to be successful in a particular field, a person must have both aptitude and interest. Interest is a preference for a particular activity. Aptitude is the potentiality to perform that activity. A person may be interested in a particular job or activity, but may not have the aptitude for it. Similarly, a person may have the potentiality for performing a job, but may not be interested in doing that. In both cases, the outcome will not be satisfactory. A student with high mechanical aptitude and strong interest in engineering is more likely to be a successful mechanical engineer. Aptitude tests are specialized in two forms: independent aptitude test and multiple aptitude test. Clerical aptitude, mechanical aptitude, numerical aptitude, and typing aptitude are independent aptitude tests. Multiple aptitude tests exist in the form of test batteries, which measure aptitude in several separate but homogeneous areas. Different aptitude tests and general aptitude test battery and the armed services vocational aptitude battery are well-known aptitude test batteries. Among these, DAT is the most commonly used educational settings. It consists of 8 independent subsets: verbal reasoning, numerical reasoning, abstract reasoning, critical speed and accuracy, mechanical reasoning, speech relations, spelling and language usage. DMOJA has developed an Indian adaptation of DAT. Several other aptitude tests have been developed in India for measuring scientific, scholastic, literary, clerical and teaching aptitudes. Creativity, in the foregoing section, you have read that there are variations in psychological attributes like intelligence, aptitude, personality and so on. Here you learn that there are differences in the potential for creativity across individuals and the manner in which creativity is expressed. Some are highly creative and others are not so creative. Some may express creativity in science and so on. Manifestations of creativity can be observed in a novel solution to a problem, an invention, composition of a poem, painting, new chemical process, an innovation in a law, a breakthrough in preventing a disease, and the like. Despite differences, one common element these is the production of something new and unique. We generally think of creativity in terms of creative persons like Tagore, Einstein, C.V. Raman, Ramanujan, etc., who have made outstanding contributions in different spheres. In recent years, our understanding of creativity has broadened. Creativity is not just limited to a selected few artists, scientists, the poet or the inventor. An ordinary individual who is engaged in simple occupations like pottery, carpentry, cooking can also be creative. However, it has been said that they are not working at the same level of creativity as an eminent scientist or a writer. Hence, we can say that individuals vary in terms of the level and the areas in which they exhibit creativity, and that all may not be operating at the same level. Einstein's theory of relativity is an example of the highest level of creativity, which implies bringing out altogether new ideas, facts, theory or a product. Another level of creativity is establishing on what has already been established earlier by way of modification, by putting things in new perspective or to new use. Research in literature suggests that children begin to develop their imagination during early years of childhood, but they express creativity mostly through physical activities and in non-verbal ways. When language and intellectual functions are fully developed and store of individual of knowledge is adequately available, creativity is expressed through verbal modes too. Those who are outstanding in their creativity may give an indication about the direction in which their creativity lies through their self-chosen activities. In some cases, however, opportunities need to be provided before they can manifest their hidden potential or creativity. How do we explain variations in potential for creativity? As in case of other mental and physical characteristics, such variations can be attributed to the complex interaction of heredity and environment. There is no disagreement that creativity is determined both heredity and environment. Limits of the creative potential are set of heredity. Environmental factors stimulate the development of creativity. How much of the creative potential can be realized, when and in what specific form and direction is largely determined by environmental factors such as motivation, commitment, family support, peer influences, training, opportunities, etc. Although no amount of training can perform an average person to the level of Tagore, Shakespeare, etc., but it is also true that every individual can raise her or his level of creative potential beyond its present level. In this context, you have already read in class 11 about strategies to enhance creativity. Creativity and intelligence. One important debate in understanding the variations in creativity has been the relationship of creativity with intelligence. Let us take an example of two students in the class. Sunita is regarded by her teachers as an excellent student. She does her work on time, scores the highest grades in the class, listens to instructions with care, grasps quickly, reproduces accurately, but she rarely comes out with ideas which are her own. Rita is another student who is just average in her studies and has not achieved high grade consistently. She prefers to learn on her own. She improvises new ways of helping her mother at home and comes up with new ways of doing her homework and assignments. The former is considered to be more intelligent than the latter as more creative. Thus, the person who has the ability to learn faster and reproduce accurately may be considered intelligent more than creative, unless she or he devises new ways of learning and doing. Terman in 1920s found that persons with high IQ were not necessarily creative. At the same time, creative ideas could come from persons who did not have very high IQ. Other research have shown that not even one of those identified as gifted followed up throughout their adult life had become well known for creativity in some field.
Researchers have also found that both high and low creativity can be found in highly intelligent children and also children of average intelligence. The same person thus can be creative as well as intelligent, but it is not necessary that intelligent ones in the conventional sense must be creative intelligence. Therefore, by itself does not create and ensure creativity. Researchers have always found that the relationship between creativity and intelligence is positive. All creative acts require a minimum ability to acquire knowledge and capacity to comprehend, retain and retrieve. Creative writers, for example, need facility in dealing with language. The artist must understand the effect it will produce by a particular technique of painting. A scientist must be able to reason and so on. Hence, a certain level of intelligence is required for creativity, but beyond that, intelligence does not correlate with the creativity. It can be concluded that creativity can take many forms and blends. Some may have more of intellectual attributes, others may have more of attributes associated with creativity. But what are the attributes of a creative person? What are the attributes of a creative person? You may likely to discuss the attributes which are common to all kinds of creative person. Creativity test came into existence to assess variation in terms of potential for creativity in contrast to intelligence. A general feature of most of the creativity test is that they are open-ended. They permit the person to think of different answers to the questions or problems of in what terms of her or his experiences, whatever these may have been. These help the individual to go in different directions. There are no specified answers to questions or problems in creativity tests. Therefore, there is freedom to use one's imagination, express it in an original ways. Creativity tests involve divergent thinking and assess such abilities as ability to produce a variety of ideas, that is, ideas which are off-beat in track, ability to see new relationships between seemingly unrelated things, ability to guess causes and consequences, ability to put things in a new context. This is contrary to the test of intelligence, which mostly involves convergent thinking. In test of intelligence, the person has to think of the right solution to the problem and focus is on assessing abilities such as memory, logical reasoning, accuracy, perceptual ability, and clear thinking. There is little scope for the expression of spontaneity, originality, and imagination. Since expressions of creativity are varied, tests have been developed using different stimuli like words, figures, action, and sounds. These tests measure general creative thinking abilities, like ability to think of a variety of ideas on a given topic or situation. Alternative ways of looking at things, problems or situations to guess causes and consequences, to think unusual ideas to improve and to use common objects, ask unusual questions and so on. A few investigators have always developed tests of creativity in different areas, such as literary creativity, scientific creativity, mathematical creativity. Some of the famous psychologists who have developed creativity tests are Guilford, Torrance, Katina, Wallace, and Kogan, Paramesh, Becker Mehdi, and Passy. Each test has set of manual and interpretation guide. These can be used only after extensive training in administration and interpretation of test course. Summary: individuals vary in their physical and psychological characteristics. Individual differences refer to distinctiveness and variation in people's characteristics and behavior patterns. A wide variety of personal attributes, such as intelligence, aptitude, interest, personality, and values can be assessed. Psychologists assess these attributes through psychological tests, interviews, case studies, observations, and self-reports. The term intelligence refers to an individual's capacity to understand the world, think rationally, and use resources effectively to meet the demands of life. Intellectual development is a product of complex interplay of hereditary factors and environmental conditions. The psychometric approaches to intelligence lay emphasis on studying intelligence as a constellation of abilities expressed in quantitative terms such as IQ. The more recent theories representing information processing approaches, Sternberg's triarchic theory and Das's PASS model, describe the processes underlying intelligent behavior. Howard Gardner suggests that there are 8 different kinds of intelligence. Intelligence assessed with the help of specially designed tests. Intelligence tests may be of verbal or performance type, can be administered individually or groups, or may be culturally based or culturally fair. are the two extremes of intelligence. Are the intellectually deficient persons and the intellectually gifted? Culture provides a context for intellectual development. Western culture promotes technological intelligence based on skills of analysis, performance, speed, and achievement orientation. In contrast, non-Western cultures value self-reflection, social and emotional competence as signs of intelligent behavior. Indian culture promotes integral intelligence that emphasizes connectivity with people and the larger social world. Emotional intelligence involves the ability to perceive, manage one's and others' feelings and emotions, to motivate oneself and restrain one's impulses, and to handle interpersonal relationships effectively. Aptitude refers to an individual's potential for acquiring some specific skills. Aptitude tests predict what an individual will be able to do given proper training and environment. Creativity is the ability to produce ideas, objects and problems, solutions that are novel, appropriate and useful. Certain level of intelligence is necessary to be creative, but high level of intelligence, however, does not ensure that a person would be certainly creative.